The quantitative foundations with respect to derivative as an instrument can be categorized into two broad headings. One is compounding, another one is discounting. And in both these cases, there is something called as lump sum. Either you can invest your money in one lot. Maybe I'm investing 10 lakh rupees into the capital market. Or I can go with, suppose if I'm a salaried person, I may not be able to invest one lump sum at a time. So in that case, I might be thinking of investing at regular intervals. And when I'm going to invest at regular intervals, a stipulated amount for a certain period of time, that is what I call as an annuity. It's actually a series of payments made at regular intervals for a stipulated time. Okay, so that's what I call as annuity. And so the concept of compounding and discounting covers both investment made in lump sum as well as investment made in annuity. So I repeat, the concept of compounding helped me to find out what is the value of my investment in future. That includes the interest factor which I'm going to get. The interest factor is added to my investment to find out what is it I'm going to get in future if I'm investing 10 lakh rupees or if I'm investing 10,000 rupees. Okay. Discounting is, suppose if I know that after 1 year, I'm going to get, say, 1,10,000, I would like to know what is the value of that money now. And if 1 lakh, I'm investing 1 lakh rupees, and after 1 year, I'm going to get 1,10,000. And when I'm looking at that 1,10,000, which I'm going to get after 1 year, the present value of 1,10,000, if it is less than 1 lakh, in the present time, if it is less than 1 lakh, then there is no point in me investing that money. I can go with my consumption. Because the 1 lakh which I'm having in my hand, currently it is 1 lakh. The value is same. But after 1 year, I might be getting an interest of 10%. So the money in my hand would be 1,10,000. But if that 1,10,000 in the current perspective, when I'm looking at that 1,10,000, the PV, the present value of that, if it is less than 1 lakh, logically, there is no point in making that investment. There is no point in making that sacrifice. So that is why we go with the concept of discounting also. At times, we would like to know what is the present value of a lump sum or maybe a payment which we receive in future. So the same, when we are talking about an insurance or when we are talking about a mutual fund, we make the investment and we are being projected with a certain return that will be, or a return for which we are eligible in future. So if maybe when I look from now, a return of 10 lakh after 10 years might be a lump sum amount for me. But there is another concept called time value of money. As the in the general condition, as years pass by, value of money generally depreciate, right? So I'm going to get with 10 lakh today, maybe after 10 years I may not get it. So I should make sure that this 10 lakh definitely is growing. I should be in a position to get more than what I should have got now. Otherwise, there is no point in waiting for 10 years for this 10 lakh to grow. So that is a concept of discounting. So one is looking at what is the future lump sum which I'm going to get. Another one is what is the value. Discounting talks about what is the value of a lump sum which I'm going to get after 10 years in the zeroth period. Now, in the present period. If that value is better than, it is higher than what I'm having in my hand now, okay, then I should be in a position to go with the decision of investing my money. So that is why the quantitative foundation of derivative depends upon, it is same for all types of investment, equally same for the derivative instrument. It depends upon the time value of money and also the return expectation which we will be getting. If we sacrifice our current consumption and make a saving, when we are sacrificing our current consumption and making an investment means we expect something better. So that's the logic which is going to guide us. Now we are going to learn in today's class, what is compounding all about? Okay. Compounding is nothing but I'm going to look at, suppose if I have an opportunity to invest my money with bank, okay, and the bank is paying me maybe 8% interest. So I'm looking at what is that? What is the total amount? What is the future value of 1,000 at 8%? Okay, that is what we call by future value. So if the formula for computing that, the general formula is present value into 1 plus I by N into the whole raised to N, N into T. Now, what you have to remember is maybe the simplest of this is present value into 1 plus I raised to N into, when we are talking with the perspective of how many times it is being compounded, there comes this factor, N divided by N. Otherwise, it is 1 plus I raised to N. But if I'm saying that my money is compounded 2 times in a year, or if I'm saying that my money is compounded 4 times in a year, then this concept of N comes. Otherwise, it's just present value into 1 plus I raised to N. But the general is in the current perspective where we are talking about a savings account, which is compounded on a daily basis. Now, people believe that if compounding is done at a sequence or maybe at regular intervals, it's far better than going in annually. Because when you talk about compounding, it is principal plus interest. The interest you will earn till that time will be compounded. So the money which you're going to get, the chance of increasing your money is high when compounding is done frequently. So in that case, our formula becomes present value into 1 plus I by N raised to N into T. So here what we are trying to understand is this N is how many times it is compounded. Say, for example, it is annual compounding, then nothing. It will become 1 plus I. If the present value is, imagine if the present value is 1,000, okay? I'm going to compute my future value where the interest rate is 10% and it is compounded annually, then this formula is 1,000 into 1 plus 10%, so 0.10, and raised to number of years, how many years? Maybe after 1 year, if I'm looking at 1, it will be raised to 1. If I'm looking at 2, it will be 2 in the sense 2 years, it will be raised to 2. That's a simple thing. Now, that's the first one where compounding is done annually. Now we are looking at compounding done half yearly. So in a year, you will have 2 times compounding being done for the amount. So in that case, it will come like this. Present value remains same, 1,000 into 1 plus I is 10%, so 0.10 divided by 2. Instead of 1, it would be 2, because number of times compounded in a year is 2 raised to N. N is, it is number of time. So here it would be 2 into number of years, T, time. So that will be, if it is 1 year, fine, 1. N into 1. If it is for 2 years, then it will be 2. So that's how we go with the compounding formula. So along with that, I have put this also. Maybe some of you are familiar with this. This is from the logarithm table, compounding factor table. You take it as, in this case, it would be I is interest for 10% and N will be for, how many years? How many times you're going with. So future value would be present value into compounding factor table, the value which you take it from the compounding factor table and multiply with. Here it would be, say, if it is 1,000 into the value which you get from the table based on your interest rate and number of times. So that is the basic formula for a compounding technique. That is, you are looking at 1,000 rupees. If I invest for 10 years, what is the amount which I'm going to get? If my investment is for 10 years, the formula would be 1,000 into 1 plus I. We keep the interest as 10%. So 0.10. And if it is compounded annually, here the relevance of N is not there. One time, right? The whole raised to 1 into T, 10 years. we have said for a period of 10 years. So the T is 10, right? So that is the basic formula for compounding. Tomorrow we will do exercise on this. And then here, in case if compounding is done annually, the effective rate of interest is same, which we will know in a better way when we are actually doing it. Because when I'm talking about present value, say we take 1,000 rupees, okay? We are compounding it annually and the interest rate is 10, what you get would be 1,100 after first year. Because that is 10% in one lump sum, 1,000, it has been, you are taken to the 1 year period. So after 1 year, you will get 1,100, that's clear. But when you are going with a compounding of maybe quarterly or half yearly or monthly, the amount which you're going to get would be a little more higher. Logically, we can understand why. Because here we are, the n number of times compounding is done increases. If it is monthly, it will become 12 times. If it is half yearly, it will become 2 times. If it is quarterly, it will become 4 times. So naturally, the amount would be more. So that is where we go with the concept of effective rate of interest. When you have multi-period compounding, the concept is the effective rate of interest, if it is compounded once, it's same, 10%. But the effective rate of interest, if it is compounded twice, it is higher than one time. The effective rate of interest, if it is compounded 4 times, it is much higher than 2 times. So that is what we look by the formula 1 plus I by M minus 1. When the multi-period compound, how many period you go with the compounding, which we are going to do. We will do all the exercise on all these today. I'm just giving you a brief introduction. So the effective rate of interest comes into when compounding is done for multiple period. Because if you are going with just one-time compounding, there is the effective rate of interest remains same as the actual interest rate. But if you're going for multiple times, the effective rate of interest might be more because you are compounding again and again with. When once you're compounding with, the compounding includes your principal amount plus your interest earned till that period. Suppose if I'm going with half yearly compounding, how do I do is in the 6 months, I will do a compounding which includes my principal amount plus the interest earned till that 6 months. So definitely the amount which I would be getting is little higher. That's why they go with the concept of daily compounding when we are talking about a savings account. So that's what we call as an effective rate of interest. Okay. Then doubling period. This is actually a rule which has been followed by some of the, it's not relevant when the time value of money is too high. Now, when the when the depreciation rate of money is too high, people will not go with the doubling period concept. Because the depreciation in the economy, if it is very high, then, or inflation, if it is very high, people don't go for this doubling period concept. You might have heard, or maybe you might have heard from your parents, that some of the NSE deposits, they had a concept of giving you with the double the amount what you invest in 5 year period. That is, if I have invested 10 lakh, I'm going to get 20 lakh after 5 years. We had a scheme like that maybe 5 to 10 years before. Right. Now they don't go with doubling. They go with saying that, okay, you are going to get, if I invest 10 lakh, maybe they say an amount which you are going to get. It's not doubling. Because here now the inflation is too high and the depreciation rate of money is also very high. So that is why. But the doubling concept is, it can be put under two. One is Rule 72, another one is Rule 69. In case of Rule 72, the doubling period is computed as using this formula, which is 72 divided by rate of interest. Rate of interest, they will do, it's actually a mathematical calculation. They will look into what is the kind of interest to be given. And that is actually the formula for Rule 72. Rule 69, it is little different, where they go with 0.35 plus 69 by rate of interest. Okay, so these two are something which we have to by heart, even though in the actual scenario, many of the investments will not be having such an option. In fact, now I don't believe any of the investments available have this option of doubling. Okay, because the inflation rate is pretty high. Right. Now we are talking about the concept of discrete and continuous compounding. Discrete compounding, it's very easy for you to understand. Discrete compounding happens at regular intervals. I was talking about compounding being done annually, compounding being done half yearly, compounding being done maybe quarterly. That all comes under discrete compounding. But continuous compounding, that takes up the smallest possible interval. If possible, that go with the concept of daily compounding, because banks say that on saving account, they go with daily compounding concept, even though literally how it happens here is, this is how future values, present value into E, exponential, mathematical expression, exponential. Exponential E is having a value of 2.7183 raised to R into T. R is interest rate, T is time period. So that is when we are talking about continuous compounding, here the period of compounding is much smaller than what we talk about a discrete. Discrete generally go with maximum of month, not below that. But continuous is as far as possible you go with the smallest value, so that the amount that will be got by an investor would be very huge when you compare with the concept of discrete compounding. So that's very attractive to the investor. So future value is equal to present value into E raised to R into T. E is already having a mathematical expression value, 2.7183, that is the value of exponential. So that is what we call as discrete and continuous compounding. Now there is another concept where, as I said at the beginning, either you can invest a lump sum or you can go with a stream of equal cash flows at regular intervals for a stipulated period. When you go with the concept of equal cash flows at regular intervals for a stipulated period, you call that as an annuity. Say, for example, I'm going to invest 5,000 every month for 10 years, for the next 10 years. Every month at the beginning of the month for the next 10 years. That's something called as annuity. But there is another concept. I can invest 5,000 at the end of the month for 10 years. There is a little difference. One is at the beginning, another one is at the end. So that's why there are two types of annuity. One is at the end of the month, or it can be end of the year, depending upon what is your frequency. End of the year annuity, the computation, the formula used for computation is like this, where present annuity amount, whatever the amount which you're going to invest, into 1 plus R. R is nothing but the interest rate raised to N is what you call as the number, the year, okay? And the only difference which we find, if it is at the beginning of the year, then you have to multiply with 1 plus R. Along with this, the formula remains same. Along with that, you have to multiply it with 1 plus R. So if it is at the end of the every year, the formula used here is this. But if it is at the beginning of the year, there is a difference. Why? Because that money is remaining with the bank from January 1st. Or if you're talking about a case of January 30th, 1 month less. Almost 1 month, because towards the end you're investing. The availability of fund is for a lesser period when you compare with the beginning of the period. So that's the difference with respect to annuity at the end of every year and annuity at the beginning of every year. So this is the concept of compounding which we are talking about. Actually, compounding is a concept which talks about future value of money. In simple terms, if somebody asks you what is compounding, it is what is the future value of a money or of an amount that is invested today. And that future value depends upon the rate of interest and the period for which you have put. Right? If I put for a longer time, the amount which I get would be higher. If my interest rates are high, okay, then again, I will get a better amount. And again, one more concept that is going to affect compounding is how many times it is compounded in a year. The number of times it is compounded in a year. Suppose if I am putting any, say for example, if I have two options, okay, I have 1 lakh with me. I have two options where one party is giving the interest rate remains same for both the cases. Say, for example, both of them are offering me 8% interest, okay? But company A is offering me a chance of being compounded half yearly, that is two times a year. And company B is offering me an opportunity of compounding one time annually, then definitely I should be preferring company A because I have an opportunity to earn more. Because how does that happen? The company would be compounding or calculating my amount as like this. After 6 months, they will go with my principal plus the interest earned till that time for compounding or finding out the amount which should be given at the end of the period. But in case of company B, they will be just looking into compounding at the end of the period. They've already said this is how it happens. So that is why the number of times the amount is compounded is very important when we go with an investment. That's why banks sometimes they make it attractive that they say that compounding is done half yearly or quarterly so that our investment becomes more attractive. Then we talked about the concept of as we say, annuity. Annuity is a concept where you have, say I get a monthly salary. So I know that it will be easy for me to make up an investment based on my monthly income. So what I do is every month I'm going to go with an amount as an investment into capital market. I do that. Every month a stipulated amount is going into capital market. Same amount. There are possibilities where you can change the amount, but when the amount remains same, you call that as an annuity. Equal amount at equal intervals for a stipulated period, that's what we call as annuity. And how do we go with the computing of the amount which you're going to get, the future value of the amount which you're going to get is the concept of compounding. So compounding with respect to annuity can happen in two forms. One is if I'm investing my amount at the beginning. Say for example, I can say that first of every month or first of January every year. If it is annually, I will say first of every month. Or I have an option where suppose if I get my salary at the end of every, there are two types. Some people get the salary at the at the end of the same month itself, or some people get the salary at the beginning of next month. Suppose if my income is scheduled towards the end of the month, maybe I can plan that I'm making my investment at the end of the month. I'm actually giving my investment date as 30th of every month or 30th of April if it is annually. So in that case, the compounding of annuity is little different. That's why we have two formulas here. The first one where it is at the end of the year and when it is at the beginning of the year. You have another possibility, little more higher possibility of earning a return. So this is what we had been discussing in our class. And of course, there is a concept of effective rate of interest, which talks about or which come into action when the compounding is done many times in an year. Or many times during a period, because if I'm promised with 10% and the computation, the amount which I'm getting will be different if the computation is half yearly or if it is done annually or maybe if it is done quarterly or monthly. Definitely in this case, if the compounding is done on a monthly basis, that amount will be higher than when I compare it with an annual compounding. So that's why the concept of effective rate of interest will come when we have multi-period compounding, right? And I started with the basic formula of compounding. I am looking at what is the future value of an amount which I am investing today. I am looking at future value of 10 lakh which I am investing today. So there are two things which I have to take care of. One is my rate of interest. Two is how many years I am going to put. And one more thing will be equally important for me, how many times in an year I'm going to go with the compounding. So that's why the formula is 1 plus I is interest rate, N is times, and T is number of years. So this is actually the simplest formula if you ask, it will be present value into 1 plus I or 1 plus R. Some textbooks use the word R for interest, some textbooks use the word I. That's the simplest one. 1 plus I if it is compounded for 1 year. Raised to, T is there, raised to T. So if it is for 1 year, it will be raised to 1. And if it is for 2 years, it will be a present amount, say 10 lakh into 1 plus. If it, the interest rate is 10%, it would be 1 plus 0.10 raised to, if it is for 5 years, it will be raised to 5. That's the simplest formula. But when I'm talking about a multi-period compounding, then I will have something called as number of times it's compounded, where it is represented by A. So this is all about compounding. We started our class with discussing about the time value. The first concept is, what is the future value of an amount which I invest today? Okay, that is what we call as compounding. Now, there is another concept which we will be discussing in our next class, that is discounting. Discounting talks about a lump sum which I'm getting in future. Okay, I am being promised to get an amount in future. I would like to know what is the value of that amount which I'm getting in future. Basically, I will be looking into such type of calculation when I'm planning for an investment, because every investment is a sacrifice of present consumption. So if I'm planning to invest 10 lakh, definitely that 10 lakh is taken away from my sacrifice, because I've decided I'm not going to spend it. I'm going to invest it to future so that I will have a better position. So I'm evaluating whether my position is better. Sometimes government will discourage investments when there are plenty of money in the, you know, lying dead with no investment opportunities, no future investment opportunities. Developed countries, most of the developed countries, what they do is they discourage future investment. The reason here is they have lot of money remaining idle without coming into the market for investment. If I'm sacrificing my consumption, it means that the money is not coming into the market in the current period. So what they do is they keep the interest rate very less, very low, maybe 4%, 3% or 2%. So people will look into that amount like this. That is, okay, I'm going to invest 10 lakh. I'm being promised with 3% after maybe 5 years. So I'm looking at what is the value of that amount which I'm getting at 5 years, which includes the principal plus 3% interest rate. What is the present value? And if that present value is equal or maybe less, sometimes because of the depreciation in the value of money, sometimes it will be less than the present value of that, what I'm investing. So in that case, people will not go for investment. That is where you we discuss the concept of discounting or present value of money. Right? If I'm getting a series of cash flow in future, what is the present value of it in future, in the present time? That is something which we are going to discuss in the next class.